Please come sit with,
These chairs are very hard to make.
I understand.
Thank you.
You sit on this side tonight. Good.
So by way of introductions, my name is Mark Sullivan. I've served as advisor to the Washington State Military Transition Council. So this is one of a series of military spouse listening sessions that we're doing around the state. I should note that they are being recorded on Facebook Live. So if you're going to say it, know that it's going to be recorded for posterity. This is coming out of a lot of work that's happened around military spouses. About a year ago, the Military Transition Council decided to focus on military spouse employment as a priority. And since that time, we've created a new executive order that addresses the need of military spouses. And our leadership has essentially said, we actually want to go out and talk to military spouses before we develop any new strategies. So with that, we are looking for the input of folks who work with spouses, from spouses themselves, on what's working and what's not. So with that, I'm going to have a few other folks introduce themselves. Julie Bergman.
Right over here.
So Julie is our host. Can you introduce yourself?
Julie Bergman. I work from the Airmen and Family Readiness Center. And I have several team members here, Deputy Midland, Chris Keegan, and Lisa Mackey over at the end. We all came together to help military spouses with their employment needs.
Excellent. Thank you, Julie. Alfie, you want to introduce yourself?
Sure. My name is Alfie Alvarado, and I am the director here in Washington State Department of Veterans Affairs. My office is in Olympia, and as Mark said, this is part of the emphasis that the governor has placed on what is called the Washington Military Transition Council. Now we have readiness and a focus on the family, not just on the veteran or the ex-service service member, because we know how critical the family is to the overall health of the veteran, and also how important the family is when it comes to be able to have a holistic approach. This is why we're doing these sessions with you. We are recording them, and I know military spouses are not shy. Speak your mind, because there are going to be others that are not here that are going to want to hear what you have to say, and will actually be able to make comments. So we're monitoring the comments as we go along. And if there are questions, Paul is going to be able to pose the questions for us to be able to respond to them, or later on be able to do IOUs to them and ensure that their feedback is also heard. That's why it's so important for us to have this kind of House of Representatives in here. You're representing thousands of people. And therefore, it's so important for us to be able to hear that feedback from you.
Right. Susie, can you introduce yourself?
Sure. Hi, I'm Susie Levine. I'm the Commissioner for the Employment Security Department. And our vision is the nation's best and most future-ready workforce with opportunities for all here in Washington State. And I am the daughter of a military spouse, and so this is also very personal for me to be able to listen and help in whatever ways possible help military spouses have the dignity of work. And so part of what Alfie and I are going to do, and now with Lisa as well coming on board with this, very excited, is listen, listen, listen. This is about listening first. And there's a lot going on nationally, but it's also how do we apply the local angle and local aspect to it and hear the local voices. And this is the second of our military spouse listening sessions, and then we will do several more, and then compile what we've heard, and publish and share it out, get some feedback, and then have that inform what might need to happen at the legislative level, at the regulatory level, and through our different employment spaces that we have access to. So I'm so humbled to be here with you all and to have the opportunity to listen.
Thank you. Lisa.
Thank you. I'm Lisa Brown. I'm the director of our state's Department of Commerce, formerly a state legislator from here in Spokane for about 20 years, and formerly with WSU Spokane. I've also joined by Julia Havens, who is our outreach, on our outreach team, specifically for Eastern Washington. Commerce has offices in Olympia, Seattle, and Spokane, and our mission is to strengthen communities and some of the building blocks that we have as tools to do that. We work on affordable housing and countering homelessness. Youth homelessness is a new project that we're working on across the state. We work on infrastructure projects with local governments. We have the state's energy office, energy policy, but also low-income weatherization and looking to the future of clean energy, and then economic development. And along those lines, we have sector leads in different areas. So we actually have a sector lead, Christina Reeves, who's also a state representative, who works specifically on military and defense as an economic sector, which of course, it's very large for this region, for the whole state, and we do economic analysis and promote workforce education and other initiatives that can help strengthen the sector. So I'm really happy to be here. Looking forward to hearing what you have to say and coming up with some good collaborative solutions to help move things forward for spouses and military families.
Excellent, thank you so much. We'll do around the room here in just a moment, but I also want to introduce some other local leaders. If we can have Jenny and then Mark introduce yourselves.
Thank you. I am Jenny Weber. I am the Eastern Region Director for the Employment Security Department. And our work in the field, out in the Spokane and adjacent areas, is under the brand of WorkSource. We are engaged partners in the WorkSource system, bringing all of our employment security resources, services, and programs to the community to assist our job seeker customers and meet our employer customer demands for a talented workforce.
Excellent. Thank you, Jenny. And Mark?
Hi there, I'm Mark Mackey. I'm the CEO of the Spokane Workforce Council. We're responsible for workforce development in Spokane County. So my job is to make sure that businesses have the right talented people to go to work for them. So I'm very interested in plugging more military spouses into our local labor force. It's key for me to have every single person in our area working to the best of their ability, at the top of their level, of their capabilities, out in our local economy. As you probably know, we're seeing a lot of low unemployment rates across the country. We're no different here in Spokane, and so I need every single person who wants to go to work, to go to work. We operate the local WorkSource system here in Spokane. I actually have staff, Debbie Medlin, located here on the base, helping connect spouses to employment opportunities. So please consider us a resource as you're seeking employment and looking for ways to plug into our local economy. We're here to help, and I need every single one of you to be out there going to work if you want to in our local area.
Excellent. Thank you. So we'll go around the room here. We'll actually start in the back and ask folks to introduce yourselves. You can tell us your name. Let us know if you're a spouse of a current or former service member or Guard or Reserve member. And also, how long have you been either at Fairchild or in the Spokane area?
Okay. I'm Alan Hart. I'm retired military just last year. Mark Maggie brought me on, asked me kindly to be part of his Workforce Council Board, so that I'm now the vice chair and kind of getting near and dear to my heart, spouses. My wife followed me around for 27 years, and now she's told me she's running the show and having her own career. She has not had that chance. So it's always near and dear to me to try to help and help my former military members and the former spouses of the military. Thank you.
My name is Rufus Over, and I have choice off chairs. I'm retired Army. I've been in the health field for 60 years. Part military, part civilian life. I am a member of the Veterans Advisory Commission here in Washington, appointed by the governor, and respond to Alfie in any way we can. I also work with Kat, who will introduce herself in a minute, on the county veterans board. And as I say, I'm here however I can help. I'm anxious to hear and listen to see if some of the issues are not the same issues I heard 30 years ago, which they probably are.
Excellent. Kat, can you briefly introduce yourself?
I can indeed. My name is Kat Nichols. I am the director for the Regional Veterans Services Center here in Spokane. It is a joint effort between your Washington State Department of Veterans Affairs and Spokane County. We are providing claims and benefits services, transition services, employment services, and financial services to veterans and families. Really love being here. It's a new venture. We had a grand opening on March 3rd of this year, and we've been busy ever since. And I am a former service member and a former spouse.
spouse of a service member. So.
Current spouse of a former service member.
Yeah, that's it. Current spouse of a former service member. Yeah, I kept him, yeah.
All right.
Hello, my name is Blanche Hendershock. I've been an Air Force spouse for 17 years, and we've been located at Fairchild for 5 of those.
I'm Melinda Bowman, and I am a former spouse of almost 20 years of an active duty Navy veteran, and I'm now a current spouse of a retired Air Force veteran, and I have lived in 8 states and 3 countries, and have experienced being kind of forced to relocate on a regular basis. And so I've been in Spokane. I was born and raised in the area, and then I was gone for 20 years, and now I'm back for the past 5 years. And so.
Julia Havens, Department of Commerce, Community Outreach. I have grown up in Spokane, and I'm raising my children there, so lifer, I guess, almost. And I serve all of Eastern Washington right now. So.
Thank you.
I'm Chris Salmi. I am the spouse of the active duty service member stationed here. We've been here for about a year.
Excellent. You already introduced yourself, so.
How you doing? I'm Chris Steven. I work at the Airman and Family Readiness Center, current base. I'm originally from Connecticut. I got here in 2013 as an enlisted active duty. I was lucky enough to retire here at Air and find gainful employment. So that's what Spokane's home.
Mike Ramosa, Employment Security Department, Spokane office. I actually have an office here on Fairchild Air Force Base. I work with transitioning service members and help them with their job search.
I'm Ty Corbett, and I am an employment transition coach with Washington National Guard Joint Services Support, and I work with unemployment issues with specifically with the Guards, as I'm with the Air Washington National Guard. But we work with everybody: veterans, service transit service members, reservists, and families, and with all their employment needs. So,
thank you.
I'm Lisa Mackey. I'm a military and family life counselor housed out of the Airman and Family Readiness Center. And I kind of just wanted to see what our spouses are having to go through, because I feel like I have a very intimate look in their personal issues that they go through every day.
Thank you.
I'm Dina Sleep. I'm the coordinator for all things veteran services at Spokane Community College. Also the recent widow of a former Marine that was 100% service connected.
Heather Rame, I'm the Vet Corps Coordinator for Region 5 here for your Washington Department of Veterans Affairs. I'm actually from Eastern Washington, born and raised. I'm also a U.S. Army veteran, retired after 22 years. And my husband is a medically separated veteran. So we've both been, he's either been my dependent or I've been his dependent at different times. But I manage the Vet Corps program, as well as some of the TBI stuff that goes on with our veterans in the college level and in just Eastern Washington in general. So I actually work with a lot of dependents that are seeking services for their spouse, and sometimes they're seeking services for themselves. So
and so that makes you also a spouse yourself.
Exactly. Yes.
Hannah, can you introduce yourself?
Happy to. I'm Hannah Shep. I work at the WorkSource office. I'm a local veterans employment representative. I help employers who are trying to hire and retain veterans and their military spouses.
Sir, Mr. Cruz, can you introduce yourself?
Okay, I'm going to step away from there, so it's not too loud. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Paul Cruz, and I also work for your Washington State Department of Veterans Affairs. Retired Army guy, and I'm passionate about this because about 70% of my family has served in the military from Guam. One way to get off the island, which is awesome. It's just a pleasure to be here, and I always love coming to this side of the mountains. Unfortunately, I am located in our Olympia office, but I work hand in hand with Kat. We do a lot of things and coordinate things together to provide the best services throughout the state.
Thank you. Continue our way around.
My name is Rob Crow. I'm the Employment Security Department Administrator out of WorkSource Spokane, supporting the team out there to assist all of you in both your efforts to gain employment and also find the talent that you might need for companies that you would be involved in. I've been in Spokane for 26 years now, this tour of duty, I guess. Not military connected, but lived here for a couple of years as a teenager. So. Consider Spokane my home.
I'm Kevin Williams. I'm an Air Force retiree as well. Retired just about 3.5-4 years ago, right here at Fairchild. Got to spend my last 4 years here, had never been to Spokane except for some training, and fell in love with it. My family and I, so we decided to stay. Mark was gracious enough to hire me into the position that I'm in now to be the operator for the Worksource campus, which houses, of course, our Worksource Center, our adult comprehensive center that we have there, as well as the Spokane Resource Center, which is the social services comprehensive center that we have, and also our Next Generation Zone, which serves youth and young adults. My name is Brian Altmeyer. I work at the Airman Family Readiness Center. I'm currently in the Army Reserves, and have been in there for 19 years, and born and raised in Spokane.
Hi, my name is Abby Westad. I have been a spouse for 10 years, but I was a child as well. My dad was in the military for 20 years. We've been in Spokane for 2.5 years.
Gabby Mifflin, Worksource Spokane at Fairchild Air Force Base. I work with military spouses, finding them employment in the area, along with Hannah and Julie and Chris. We all work together. And also, I did want to let you know that Lisa Matthews is kind of part of our employment team, too, helping as a military family life counselor. She assists with those anxieties and any interview anxieties that our spouses have, so we work directly together.
And I'm Sam Mitchell, the administrator for ESB at Joint Base Lewis-McChord, America's only inside-the-gate comprehensive job center.
Well,
and retired Air Force.
Excellent. Thank you all very much. So the format of this is probably what we would call a reverse town hall. So this isn't an opportunity for Alfie and Susie and Lisa to talk at you. It's an opportunity for you to get insight and input to them. So with that, we have a few questions. These things usually evolve a little bit organically, so folks will offer whatever insight or input they want to, but we've got some questions to help sort of lead and guide that conversation. So I'm going to kick off with the first question, which is, what are your most significant career roadblocks as a military spouse, and what are some solutions that you have seen working effectively? So, and I put that to certainly, you know, directly to the spouses who are here, both current and former active duty service members, but also the rest of you also carry the story of a lot of spouses. So if you have insights from your own work experience, please share those as well. Yes?
Okay, I know I'm not dressed appropriately today, but I am a teacher by trade. And so before I lived in Washington, I was on the island of Guam for 4 years.
Yes.
And I was able to get my licensing process through. I was able to teach there for 4 years. I taught on the base there with Rodea. I come to Washington State and they tell me that my license, I get a temporary year-long license and I have to take 5 tests to completely get my Washington State license. And that is what I struggled with after my first year. So
the portability of your license or certification, your professional credentials.
Yeah. I can relate to that. Being in 8 different states, I have 8 different teaching certificates, and each state's different, and each state is a pain in the rear end to get things. Some are easier than others. Like, I know going from Florida to Virginia, that was whatever, just fine, you're great. Coming from out of state into Washington has been very frustrating. I transferred my administrative license, and I think I send them everything they want, and then they reject it because I'm missing some little thing. And I'm like, I have sent you 3 licenses that are active from 3 different states that say that I'm perfectly great with 20 years of experience, but then I'm not good enough for the state of Washington. They make it very difficult. And so now I'm gun-shy to transfer my teaching certificate over because that's another $174. That's another round of this, another round of that, another round of transcripts from everywhere else. And, you know, it just gets very expensive. I think I've spent almost $400 now just trying to get licensed in the state of Washington, and I still don't have that piece of paper. Mm-hmm. So that prevents me now from applying for jobs that are available right now in Spokane or in Meade or whatever district because I don't have that piece of paper, although I bring a wealth of knowledge and a very varied background, teaching in multiple locations in multiple environments, and that's not valued. And that repeats itself over and over every time you PCS, or now that we're now retired here. So I think that is a roadblock. And I know that's not just for teachers. I have friends that are nurses. I have friends that are aestheticians. I have beauticians, and they have the same problems. It's expensive, and it's time consuming and everywhere is different and all these different hoops, and it makes you just kind of not even want to bother anymore. I have to say Washington, out of all of the 8 states, has been the most complicated and the most head banging against a wall, not polite language and the polite company type of situation. So that's even coming from overseas. I mean, it was easier for me to teach in Siberia than it was for me to teach in Washington State. So I can relate.
What state did you have the easiest time in being able to go through the trial?
It seems that Virginia and Rhode Island tended to be the easiest. Florida wasn't too bad. I had to contest, but it wasn't, like, the paperwork side of it wasn't too bad. Nevada, other than having to pay and then deal with just bureaucratic kind of crazy, it was pretty simple. But Washington was pretty difficult. Texas was difficult. California, I didn't even bother when we were in California. I just didn't even bother. I was like, I'm not even going through their hoops. So it's one of those things where you just make a decision. Like, do I really want to go back to college, or do I want to, you know, do these things? And it's a cost factor too. If you have to go back and take classes for SPED or whatever the new thing is, bilingual, whatever it might be, those are added costs that, oh, I have to take 15 more additional college credits at, you know, at the university, which is $400 a credit, plus fees, plus books, plus, you know, all those hidden costs. It's just maybe not worth it. Or you might just not have the financial resources.
Well, I just have a quick clarifying question. Okay. I just wanted to know, was the Siberia comment actual?
Yes. No, I've taught in Siberia. I've taught in Korea. I've taught. No, seriously. I taught in Siberia. It's fabulous, by the way. If anyone wants any information about teaching in Siberia, I can tell you. It's great.
I mean, like, that's a great headline.
Yeah, I mean, it's easier to teach in Siberia than it is to teach in the state of Washington.
I can imagine the response from some of the Lisa's former colleagues. So it's really important. Again, part of why we're capturing this is so that we can share these firsthand accounts and these experiences, because there's nothing like that to then subsequently move people to action and bring people into this conversation.
I got to teach English in Siberia to some amazing students, and it was, I'd go back in a heartbeat if I didn't have my own children. Now it's a little more expensive, a little more time, a little more difficult now, given visas and that thing, but
The problem starts even before that, even in the education process. You know, you get so many credits at one institution and then they don't transfer to the next. It can take you, 300 credits to get your teaching certification even done in the first place.
That's exactly what I was going to say, because I'm from a college. Mm-hmm. Seeing the spouses come to our college and have credits that don't transfer, or biology and English classes and math classes that are only good for 3 years, and you've got the degree and you need to do this over, especially the nursing programs, those are,
So the credits are expiring and or they aren't transferring.
Right. And then, and also with federal financial aid too, you're only allowed for a quarter school. I don't know what semester school it was, it's a little different. But you only get 270 quarter credit hours of financial aid. That's it. So now if you're having to transfer, if that's for undergraduate, graduate's a little different. For undergraduates, I used to work at Eastern Washington University, so it's a little different. You're gonna tap out. Pell Grant's gonna tap out. Any of those grant programs, they tap out at a certain credit or a certain time period. And if you're having to transfer from Florida to Washington, that happy marriage might not happen. You know, UW is notoriously difficult to transfer credits to. So that does it. Also, graduate programs. If you start a master's degree in Florida, you better finish it in Florida, because if you don't, it's not transferring anywhere else. When I got my doctorate degree, I had to purposely pick a place that would allow me to take classes online, because I knew I was going to leave, because if I would have done the degree I really wanted, I would have been having to be stuck in Massachusetts for, 5 years finishing my doctorate while my husband went and did his thing. So, it's all those things.
And there's reciprocity in so many other things between the states. Why there's not an opportunity for reciprocity for education and credentials of military and spouses is really interesting to me.
Well, it's the same thing.
I feel like we had this conversation 20 years ago and we're still having it.
Service members transferring out their credentials, even a CDL, does not transfer in Washington.
Yeah. So I think that there's a couple of aspects that I want to decouple here. One is that anybody, you don't have to be a military spouse to run into the challenges of licensure coming into Washington State. It's just that it's very acute with military spouses who are necessarily transferring PCS in every 18 months to 5 years. So it's happening to everybody. It doesn't make it okay. I'm just saying it's something that's happening to everyone. With regards to the transferability of transitioning service members of their experiences, be it a medic, be it a driver, and how that subsequently translates into a CDL or an EMT or any other certification, I think that that's a wholly separate thing of how do you make sure that those skills that they've learned in the military are easily transferring after their service or being adapted. I had a CDL trainer once say to me, listen, if somebody drives a Striker and then they drive a regular truck the same way they drove the Striker, we're in trouble. So I think there is some translation that needs to happen post-military into a civilian type of job, but I think you're right that their credit transfer is important on that front.
And just so you know, because I heard the issue of cost, because the cost of application, the cost of credits, et cetera. When I first started in the legislature, I was teaching at Eastern. At that point in time, the big issue for military families was you still had to pay out-of-state tuition.
Mm-hmm.
You didn't even qualify as a resident if you didn't live here for a year. So, and that was brought to me by the base as a challenge for them, in that particular Eastern. So that was one of the very first bills that I was able to work on and was signed by Governor Gary Locke. So these stories, these anecdotes are the way that good legislation gets made. It starts with a real story, a real barrier, a real problem. Okay, how do we solve that? Now, sometimes we end up solving it and creating other problems, right? Unintended consequences. So I'm not gonna say that that's never happened, but it's very valuable to hear the specifics of these stories.
And ultimately, your experience may end up changing in a broader sense what we do in Washington State to be able to recognize other licenses, because there's a need for teachers and all, and anybody, even whether they're a military spouse or not, if the way is paved through being able to do complex and other kind of agreements that allow for an easier way of being able to recognize the licenses, then everybody wins.
Mm-hmm.
So this is why this is so important.
So I think with my experience, I'm a teacher as well, so I've had a lot of the same experiences as these ladies with me. Mine's a little different in that we're coming up on retirement, so it's my turn. I'm ready to start my career. I'm a teacher. I go out there. I've been here for 5 years, and I still can't find a position as a teacher because I went through everything, jumped through all the hoops, got my licensure here, and I was demoted from a professional to a residency teacher. Lost all my endorsements that I'd have to go back to school to get again. I've used my GI Bill, ran out of it, used that to get my master's. So now here I am, ready to start my career. It's my turn, and it's heartbreaking.
Mm-hmm.
It's extremely heartbreaking for spouses. We're transitioning, my husband's getting out, we need another income. It's my turn, I'm ready to start and have my career and be the breadwinner for our family, in essence, and I can't. And, you know, a lot of these spouses, they get their college while husbands are deployed. We went through 6 deployments while at school full-time, raised kids. You know, we travel, we move, we have all these challenges. We grunt through it, we get through it, and then it comes time, we're excited, and then we're shut down before we have a chance. So there's a very real human aspect to the other end of it that affects our service members as well. My husband was very frustrated. He said, I'm so sorry I did this to you. So there's a very real human aspect besides just the workplace. It's the emotion. It's the, I worked so hard and so long, and then to be shut down. But we're survivors, right? We get it done. So we come back. I've officially left the field of education. I've decided it's honestly not worth it. I love to teach. I love children. I love being in the classroom. It's my passion. It's what I wanted to do. So at retirement, it's changing careers. Something totally different than what I thought I would be doing. Something that I'm finding I have another passion for, because that's what we do.
find another passion, another path when something stops. But if there could be a way to ease that, then I think it would make things better for all of us.
So we lost a teacher. What a sad state.
Yeah. I think you've lost three teachers.
Teachers.
Yeah.
That's, you know, and I think my struggle is you get up a ladder. So now I'm at the top of the ladder, and I'm coming from an executive level position, and suddenly now I'm here looking for work, and there are no executive level positions that you can have. And so it's either you're taking a 50% pay cut when you're the breadwinner because your spouse is retired, and now they're starting over too. So now you've got two spouses starting over, going from here to here, and then not being recognized for your talent or your age. Because as you know, 20 years down the road, you're no longer that 30-year-old. You're now a 50-year-old looking for employment. And so that, you end up with a double ding. You're getting that ageism in there, which people say, oh, that doesn't exist. Oh, yes, it does. It exists. And for a woman, I think it's even harder to hit that 50-ish age range and trying to keep a lateral or moving up the ladder. That's a true problem, and I have been blessed to be able to be a recipient of WorkSource, in Spokane. And everyone there is delightful, and I've had so many resources and so many things down there, and I'm so thankful that there for when you find out that you're no longer needed at your current position. And however, it's not geared for professionals. It's not geared for, you know, people with doctorates or master's degrees or have professional experience. It's geared more towards people that are, you know, for whatever intents and purposes, are not in that situation, right? They're more customer service, or they have another education or whatever. And that's been frustrating, because I'll go do all the things they tell me to do, but it's all geared for somebody at a different level in their career. And so that's what's been very frustrating to me in that sense, is that there's not a lot of opportunities for professionals. For those executive level professionals who are been, you know, directors of programs or executive vice presidents or vice presidents or program managers, and so much to give, but then you have nowhere to give it out anymore. And I think that's a key element that's missing, because that even goes for education. If I do get my license, I'm going to go out and apply, but then I'm at the top of the pay scale, so of course they're going to pick someone who's cheaper, right? They're less expensive. They're not going to cost you as much. And I think that's been eye-opening on my end now, being a professional and suddenly out of work. So, and that goes for even if you're not military. But I'm just saying it's hard, because then if I was moving from another state, I'd be in the same situation.
Yeah, and I've gone into interviews and spoken with people and faced, well, how long are you really going to be here if we hire you? Mm-hmm. How long are you, or did you guys just get here? Are you going to be here for a while, or are you going to leave in a year? So I've had that question many times. And a lot of the times I come to think, was that the contributing factor that cost me this position? So I think understanding that although some spouses that are professionals may not be here as long, we do have a lot to offer. We do. We have a whole wealth of it. Like her, I've taught overseas. Mm-hmm. I've taught, everywhere, right? I've taught kids K through 12. So I can teach, before I came to this date, I can teach kindergarten through high school. Not limited to 1 through 5. So it's very difficult when you go in and you get that question and you don't really know how to answer it. Well, I hope I'm here for a while. You know, the plan is to be here. But I want to tell you, WorkSource has been phenomenal. I have met with Mr. Ramos and Ms. Medlin, and they have both chipped in to really help me change careers, revamp an education resume, something a little different. So they have been instrumental in my path of changing careers to something that can serve my family going forward.
And a plug for my colleague here, because the fact is that WorkSources or whatever it's called in different states, and this is for our viewers, there is WorkSource outside of every military base pretty much. And this is probably an underutilized service, because people think about it as the unemployment office, and that is not. It is a resources office. And we need to make sure that spouses, you know, even though it's not inside of the military base for most cases, there is a representative that comes to the military base and need to be able to understand where that person is, because the active duty get the service, you know, because there's part of the transition, but the spouses don't know that this is something that is available to them too.
Mm-hmm. So as an employer, so the Employment Security Department has a large call center here in Spokane, plus we employ many who are work within the WorkSource partnership, a number of them around this room, and we have a large footprint all across the state. One of the things we're looking at is how can we be a better employer of military spouses? Mm-hmm. So how, for example, if somebody's working in, if a military spouse is working in the workforce system in Tennessee, when they get PCS to Washington State, we want them coming to get a job with us before they ever get here, so they can hit the ground running. We also are looking at, in on the west side of the mountains, we are looking at consolidating some of our call center efforts to actually create a military spouse-oriented call center to employ military spouses. You guys are so unbelievably resilient, mm-hmm. and creative and patient, Lord knows you're patient, and the ultimate in being able to work through call center challenges. And so we are looking at that for the future of our call center approach, our call center strategy. Not set in stone yet, but it's something that we're looking at. And so as an employer, it's important for us that you have a great landing pad here in Washington State for however long we can have you, whether it is retiring here, whether it is here for a small period of time, you're incredibly valuable. But it's how do we also get other employers to understand that value proposition. I'm gonna be tuning in online through Facebook. I have to fly back to be with my kids, sorry, back to Seattle. I'm leaving you in great hands with Lisa and Alfie and Jenny, but I just wanna take a moment to just thank you so much for your service to our country, and I'm so deeply grateful for you sharing your candor, and really appreciate it. If you have any other things to share, of course, here, or we're all very easy to reach. I'm gonna stay on. Thank you.
And Paul, do we have comments coming in from Facebook Live?
No comments, but some information was posted in regards on the WDVA website to address some of your questions about cost. The Army and the Air Force has added some additional rules that say when you PCS from a duty assignment to a duty assignment, you can actually claim some of those licensure costs as part of your PCS move. That's something brand new. I believe it's still within 6-8 months of its inception, but as you PCS from different duty assignments, that is available to military spouses.
So it's all the branches of the service, and it's up to $500.
Up to, correct. Now, I'm only tracking the Army and the Air Force right now. I'm not quite sure if
I can confirm the other
two. Oh, the other two? Okay, so that's great. So all of DOD has done it now. I don't know how that affects individuals who need that service that have not just recently PCS, but that's something we could look into.
Okay, so we're going to move to the second question.
So we've talked a little bit about the WorkSource system and the partners who provide support services for military spouse employment. Can folks speak to how on-base and off-base career events and other activities and programs can be improved?
Well, I'll go. We've been stationed many places, like most military families, and this is the first time I've ever heard of first at this base, so maybe getting that out to spouses. Social media would be a great platform. We're all on it. We're all on it. Social media, and that's actually how I first found out about WorkSource, was I saw it on the AFRC Facebook page. So, and my husband went to TAPS since he's retiring soon, and met Mr. Ramos, and that's how we came to WorkSource, but we had never heard of it. I didn't know it existed until we got here with the NFRC and through that. So all the other bases where I had these challenges, I didn't know they were there.
Did you live on base here?
I've lived on base here and off base.
And off
base. Yeah, and I've lived on and off base at the other bases as well. Mm-hmm. So when you're off base, you're a little less connected, so maybe an outreach to people who live off base would be important.
In other states, it would be known as an American Job Center.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. But yeah, we just call it WorkSource. That's our brand here.
But being stationed all over the place, I did not find out about WorkSource until I was unemployed and was found kind of like, oh, this is a resource for you. And I'm like, wow, I had no idea. And we spent 20 years in the military and never heard of any of it in any base, anywhere. And I wouldn't, even at Fairchild, we never heard about it. The only way I heard about it was going to the unemployment office, and they're like, oh yeah, there's this great resource. And
improvement can be just letting folks know it exists.
That would be a huge improvement, yeah, and letting them know what's there. I think there's a stigma with it. And I had a little bit of that. I'm like, oh, I'm unemployed, I got a work source. Great, you know, and it's kind of that stigma. And I think working on that, no, it's not just for people that are unemployed or, you know, got fired or whatever. It's for anybody who needs help in the career world.
It would be great to call it a professional development center.
Yeah, or just getting kind of, there's that stigma to it. And so, you know, kind of changing like what it is that it does and not that change, I guess, but changing the message, I guess, on what it does and how we get that out. I think that would be an improvement too. I think some people think it's only once you're unemployed, and it's not. I think it's valuable, and I've actually sung the praises to people that are actually employed now that I've experienced. I'm like, oh my gosh, I'm going to this great class, and this is an amazing thing, and you should go, and it's been great, but I think that's word of mouth, too, and it needs to be more amplified.
And I think to your point that you made earlier about executive level, and that is really important, and Washington State has done some great things over on Joint Base Lewis-McChord with what originally started as a Northwest Edge program, which has now morphed, but that's what we call advanced employment readiness workshops, everything from emotional intelligence, interpersonal interaction, all of the things that really get more and more important as you get into that executive level work. We offer those here at our service center, absolutely. And we'd love to see more of that come across, you know, because we have all levels of folks looking for work. And so just as much as we don't want that stigma for the work source to be it's just for unemployed people, but it's for folks who are working on professional development. We want to encourage people that if they're looking to grow, even if you're already employed but you're looking for that next better job, work source is still a great place to be because then you can work on that advanced readiness, getting your resume and your interviewing skills more aligned to those executive level positions.
I think that would be, and I didn't even know about your center. So yes, there's something I just marked. I knew about this one, but I don't know about this one. So I think making a resource page that has everything in one spot too would be very valuable. Because I had no idea you all even existed.
How about on this side of the room? When it comes to as far as inside and outside the gate services that could be improved, it's not just about employment. There are a lot of things that affect being able to be employment ready. Yeah. You know, what are some of those things that we need to maybe pay attention to?
So, probably not a person to be asking this question because I'm very centralized in what I've been looking for employment. Because I am a teacher, that's all I've been looking at are district websites. So, I don't know. I mean, I've looked on and off base, but I can't start.
So, just for the fact that, so what I do obviously deals with a lot of colleges, I tend to hire spouses because I'm outside the gate of a Air Force base or JBL. I'm very... The fact of the matter is spouses bring a lot to the table when we're trying to service our veterans just in this capacity. So I'm a proponent of that because I obviously am a spouse. But also in the fact that my husband works in a school district now. He works in a small school district in the state of Washington, which is here in Spokane, that none of you ever probably even heard of. It's called Great Northern. We've got 50 kids, except for Kevin, because his wife works there. She's a teacher there. There's two positions they're trying to fill. No. The one thing that they don't advertise enough of is the fact that those school districts don't realize that they should be going to a military base. Because my husband said, well, why haven't you gone to the base and looked for teachers? Because you aren't getting teachers that are filling it because they want higher pay because, like you said, they're at this level. And he's like, but there's teachers that are on a military base that have PCS that need employment that could easily fill those jobs.
Question, what?
Great Northern School District, and it was for a PE teacher. I think they needed a music teacher and an art teacher.
Let me just clarify a little bit more the question that I asked. When we had the session at JBLM, Joint Base Lewis-McChord, one of the areas that was a big barrier and issues of inside outside the gate was childcare. So I would assume that that's not an issue.
The cost. I'll tell you what. I have three children of my own. I have a 3-year-old, I have a 9-year-old, and a 7-year-old. Luckily, my older two are in school now, so it's a little bit cheaper. But my child, if he went off base, now for 2 months worth of pay, I paid $1,360 for on base. If I were to go off base, that would cover 1 month of childcare costs.
Yeah.
Because it's not regulated.
But I will say,
There's no spots. There's wait lists. The kids are already out of diapers by the time there's an opening.
But there is a great program, if you didn't know about it, that you can apply for a grant or a scholarship that the military does offer if you're on the wait list for the CDC for off-base care. But again, it's also finding an off-base care that's a decent provider as well, too.
That meets those qualifications
as if you were to be on base. But I will say, I have seen some daycares that do not meet the standards as if you were to be on a military installation. And it's very heart-wrenching because you're like, well, you have these expectations and you have these higher costs. How come you're not meeting these expectations, but you want me to pay more money?
Well, and do you also find struggles with, I know that some of Spokane schools have a little bit of a later start.
Yep.
Do you have issues with before and after care as well when you have a split ages of kids like that?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Once we're right in the middle of a major study about access and cost and affordability of childcare, and that is being supported through the Department of Commerce, and actually already this morning have had some interesting conversations about how we could get more childcare and Head Start ECAP, because for some military members, the level of pay, mm-hmm. the family qualifies for the Head Start, and our Washington State equivalent of Head Start is ECAP. And talking about how to increase our supply. And we also now have a stream of funding to help get the facilities off the ground. And I think some off-base care, for example, in Airway Heights, is something we should be looking at.
Mm-hmm.
As well, military spouses' breath.
I don't know what you guys. Our pay was at a point where we would never have qualified for anything that was ECAP related, for either one of us. Even when I look at my lower enlisted, I mean, even E4, they would for in the Army they wouldn't qualify. I mean, they had to be private or E2s. I mean, that was like the. How can anybody afford that?
So one of the things we have in Washington State is a subsidy system for working connections child care. But you hit a cliff really early. And you hit the cliff, which is you go from having support, and then all of a sudden you make $50 more than that, and you're completely off.
Yeah.
You're
$2 in some cases.
And your child care costs could ramp up to higher than your higher education tuition costs.
Yeah.
So that's going to end up being one of the recommendations put into this report is how to end the cliff, which basically means how to create more of a step stair set of support so that even if you're earning more money, you're still not behind because you lose the child care support.
One thing that I've noticed, I've had a chance to mentor some younger spouses, and one of the consistent problems they're having is they don't need full-time care yet. They're going to the workshops. They just need drop-in care. They don't need full-time care yet. They can't afford full-time care until they get the job as that catch 22. But they need drop-in care so they can attend the WorkSource workshop. They can go on that interview. They even to go get a decent suit or get their hair done or what we need to do to make us presentable for an interview. They need care for that. And often CDCs are full, and finding an off-base option can be kind of scary and expensive, specifically for drop-off care just for a few hours while they do those things. So something that would help spouses have that just short-term option without paying thousands of dollars up front, or depending on how many kids they have, would help.
In summer, especially, is hard because if you didn't have to school age kids, they're in school during the day. That's great, okay? But in the summer, I've had this problem. I'm fortunate that I have family in the area, but if this would have happened when we were stationed at the previous base, I had no family. So yeah, my mother wants to watch the kids. Yay, it's such a relief. But if I didn't have that option and I had to go to an interview, I was paying $86 a day just to have my kids somewhere so I could go to an interview in the summer because I had no summer care. When I was working, and we need full-time care. We are paying $1,900 a month for two kids. Two kids. And I and now they're having a state policy, you know, oh, well, they need to have their degree in early ed and all that. But you're not going to get qualified people to work in a daycare center for $12.50 an hour. You're just not. And I feel terrible. I applied for an assistant director of a daycare center. They're going to pay me $16 an hour to be the assistant director. I mean, that's just not even, I couldn't afford to put my kids in daycare for $16 an hour at the center, right? I mean, it's there's like this disconnect where you need quality care, but you can't pass it on to parents. I can't pay any more than that. I mean, that's an entire two paychecks for me just to put my kids in chairs so I can work. So I don't know what the solution is to that, but you're not going to get quality daycare if you're not paying the staff, but you can't pass that cost off to parents because they're already paying more than they can afford to put their kids in daycare. So it's like this weird catch-22, and I don't know what the answer is to that. And there's not enough. I mean, there's a wait list in every single daycare I've ever called. There's a wait list. So, you know, on top of that, there's a wait list. So.
Oh, yeah. That completely changes the dynamic.
Oh, yeah.
It's a completely different level.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the incidence of exceptional family members in the military is significantly higher than the general population.
Oh, wow. Mm-hmm.
So it is significantly higher because of environmental exposure. There's a number of different factors. So that means that there's an additional challenge when it comes to the military family in the fact that they have some kids that are wheelchair bound, you know, with ADD and a lot of different disabilities, and that does cost more when it comes to being able to care for them. So, yeah.
And frustrating when you lose your child care, you know, for something so simple as, you know, then you think you're climbing this ladder, to have that ladder taken out from underneath you to start over. So then at that point, you have to choose between working or not working. And is the services you're going to receive greater than working and being productive, which is going to help with your personal overall growth versus staying home and taking care of your family? Because, you know, paying more than what anybody's income is just not justifiable.
So how many of you at one point or the other stayed home rather than work because of that issue? Okay, so let's talk for a just brief moment about what happened then when you made that choice of staying home. What does that do to you?
Man, your self-esteem takes a hit. Mm-hmm. You can become withdrawn. You can not be a part of your community. You feel, you kind of feel like, for myself, I felt like a woman on an island. I want to work, it's my personality, I want to be productive. I want to be out there doing what I love to do. But because we're supporting our spouses who chose to serve, and we're proud of them and we love them for it. It's amazing. But because of that service, we have to give up our service and our, and to an extent, our self-care, because we can't be all we want to be. We're kind of held down in a fashion. And the majority of them, there's men too, but the majority of them are women. And we can't go out there and be the women we want to be in those leadership positions, mm-hmm. because we're supporting our spouse. Mm-hmm. So either you have a choice. You said you work for peanuts, basically after childcare and everything else, mm-hmm. or you choose to stay home and you sacrifice your whole career development for 20 years until your spouse retires.
And as the point they made before, if you do choose to go ahead and go to work for peanuts, and you're putting your kids in a child care center, there's a lot of angst that comes with that as well. I know that at one point in time, my daughter was in a child care center and was hospitalized for 4 days because of their practices of uncleanliness in the center. So my 10-month-old daughter was on an IV for 4 days in a hospital because they did not properly clean their surfaces before they changed and those types of things. So again, finding not just any daycare center, but a one that you can really trust your children to, quality environment. I mean, that's really stressful too. And on top of it, you're trying to integrate into a new position in the workforce. So there's a lot of stress with that.
There's a lot of
there's the opposite stress too, is now I've been professional and my kids have been in a decent daycare, thankfully, and they learn and they get all their education and they're in a great situation. I have to pull them out now, and now I'm taking care of them. I am not a stay-at-home mom. I love my kids. I want to do everything for them. But I am not the Pinterest stay-at-home mom, let's come up with the cool activity today kind of person. I mean, that's just not my personality. And so now I'm at home with my kids, and I want to be able to educate them. But they just lost their summer of education because I couldn't afford to put them in care. I couldn't get some money to put them somewhere, so they're getting all that education. So now I'm responsible for making sure they're not falling behind and having summer melt when they start kindergarten or second grade in the fall. So I feel like I've given a disservice to my children. So now I have the stress of, oh my God, I can't afford to put my kids in school. Oh my God, I don't have my job. Oh my goodness, my kids are falling behind in school. So it's a different level of stress. Mm-hmm. So you have stress on either side of that puzzle. Mm-hmm. Stress of putting them in substandard care and basically working for peanuts, or trying to do the stay-at-home mom, trying to be everything at once. So God bless stay-at-home moms. I utmost respect for you. I don't know how you do it. But anyways, doing that, it's stress on both ends. Regardless, it is an incredible amount of anxiety and stress that you're not providing the appropriate thing for your kids.
Yeah, I was just going to say that the majority of the demographic I see is stay-at-home moms with their second or third child. Because of all this existential stuff, and they're alone, completely alone, mm-hmm. and frazzled, and have literally no one else to turn to except for a professional that just will listen to them. So, I see those people. They don't come out of the woodwork. They don't want to leave their houses, but I see a lot of them.
Okay, and I see them in the education piece, because now they resent they resent the system, they resent their husband, their relationship takes a hit because I gave all this up for you and now I'm having to do all this over again, and you got out of the military and you decided you wanted to go with the prom wife or whatever someplace else, because that, you see that, they separate out. And it's, okay, now I have to start over. Not only do I have to start over, I have to fight for my military benefits as a spouse because I'm no longer a spouse. So you're going to see all of that in the transition to the civilian.
Well, I think it affects the kids in a major way too, because whenever there's disconnect, the parents aren't happy, the kids aren't happy. And then we see that ramification in kids where they act out, maybe at school or something other than that. I can verify that as a teacher working on military bases overseas. You definitely see moms not happy, families not happy, kids not happy, and then you have the socioeconomic status with that. With the mom doesn't work, we're spending too money for child care, we can't work, we don't have that, then the kids don't get the new clothes, they don't get that, they're wearing secondhand, thrift store shopping, things like that. So it can be very difficult for military families who already don't make as much capital as their civilian counterparts, then to fit for their children to face that, it's another level of humility, I guess, on top of that.
Thank you for the. Mm-hmm.
So there's another question we have to prime the discussion here a little bit is, you know, several of you have moved around through multiple installations and may have seen some practices that are better than what happens here in Washington State. What are some of those best practices from other bases? And maybe more broadly, if you could wave a magic wand, what would you do?
Okay, this again, sorry, teaching thing. But in DODEA, they give spouse preference, so you get 5 extra points added to your application so that you have a better chance of getting a job.
Where is that?
In Guam.
Oh,
in DODEA,
okay.
Department
okay.
of Education Activity. And they offer that for spouses as a, because, you know, veterans get 10 points, then spouses mm-hmm. get a 5-point advantage. That was just, to me, that made me feel better, more comfortable that, like, hey, I got a chance to get a job overseas, away from my family, away from everything I know. So.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to second that. Overseas was easier as a family than stateside.
Amen.
For a military family, overseas is much easier than being stateside because more is offered for spouses, more outreach, more employment opportunities on base than stateside. So living overseas and teaching overseas, it was much easier to find employment, to find quality of care, and
them to find resources than living here in the States. And if I had my magic wand moment, would be military specific center for young spouses, and maybe all spouses, of course, but primarily for young spouses, our new spouses to the military, they often don't know, and they're working, they want to work, but there's a disconnect between our young spouses and the communities they're in because they tend to be kind of withdrawn. I'm going to blame social media because that's where a lot of it, they communicate through social media. So what I'm noticing is if we had a center, there was one in Kadena, for example, a center for E4 and below, married, E4s and below, where they could network and meet each other, and senior leadership would go there, and they would mingle with the young airmen and kind of guide them in their way. We have a program that I know Ms. Salmi is very passionate about, Hug Key Spouse Program, and it's something that's phenomenal. It's absolutely phenomenal program where we have older spouses, or maybe not even older, I don't want to do it myself, but spouses, mentors. I like that word, experience. Mentor other spouses to be key spouses. So we have key spouse mentors and key spouses. And then those spouses go out and reach out. I would think it would be awesome. It's great the spouses do it because we do reach out to a lot of people. That's amazing. But it'd be great to see the outside community maybe have something like that.
So looking at that, when you've been to one military base, we've been to one military base. Everybody does everything pretty much differently. Mm-hmm. When you came to this base, is there like a spouse orientation that actually gets you connected to the services inside and outside the base?
There's part
to go to.
So at the Airman Through the Rain Center, there is a ton of information. And I was here 3 years before I visited the NRRC. So when I visited that center, I wasn't aware of what was available to me within the base. I wasn't aware of what was available to me. So when I visited them, they have all of it. It's there ready for you. It's getting the people to actually come in the door.
And know it's there to go.
Yeah, they advertise everywhere. AFRC advertises everywhere. It's just getting the airmen and the spouses in the door.
I should know, one of the things that I have recently become aware of is that for spouses who do go overseas, there's a mandatory orientation because you are moving someone to another country. And so everybody at the installation knows every spouse who is coming to that installation.
Yeah.
That doesn't happen inside the States.
Would that be something that you would recommend, to be able to have something that is like every spouse to have to go to a structure program that has inside and outside the gate services?
I would recommend that.
You can suggest it, but you can't mandate it.
That would be our hope that they come and our active duty counterparts have rights for which they attend their mandatory to attend that. And we also say, we have a program for your spouse called Heartlight. We would love for them to come. We cannot mandate spouses to take part.
You say they can't, but should they?
They should. I would absolutely recommend for them to come because, like they said, we have all of the resources here. It's at our fingertips. Just a lot of our spouses don't know about it. And that's our continuing struggle is to our active duty, to ask our active duty to share resources they have with us.
Okay, because from experience here in Washington State, TAP, the Transition Assistance Program, was not mandatory in 2011. It became mandatory in 2011 because of the work that was done here in Washington State. After doing work like this and speaking with the Vice Chief of Staff for the Army and ultimately Senator Murray, putting a bill, making TAP mandatory, and putting the resources into it to be able to have counselors and all that. So this conversation could end up being a precursor to being able to do something that puts more resources to be able to then make some kind of orientation required, let's put the word required instead of mandatory, required to be able for the purpose of really getting spouses oriented, because some people are shy and they don't like large groups and all that. So
I think that it would include spouses, because my husband went through TAP when he retired out, But then we didn't know, I still don't actually know what he was taught during that time, and I don't know how to best support him. Because now we're
welcomed, are they not?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, but that's up to the spouse to tell, you know, it's, we don't know unless our husbands tell us, or vice versa, if you're your wife's the one that's active duty. But the spouse does not necessarily know those things that are happening until after the fact, and then you kind of missed out on the link, right?
Well, I think all military, when we hear the word mandatory, we instantly shut down.
Yeah.
So when you say, you know,
this is required,
it tends to be a little bit more open-minded. Because you tell my husband mandatory, and he's like sitting here with ears completely shut off.
Yeah.
So he's not going to come home and remind me. Where if he said required, then, this is, it just was, it's like when we say, you know, are you a veteran or did you serve? Those are two, you know, it's all about how you address and deliver it, being on both sides. Because, you know, I say mandatory, I'm like, oh, I need to be there. My husband's like, oh, should I tell you? Yes, you probably should have, because he's already shut down.
Right.
And I think a lot of people
are. Devil's advocate on that. Spouses also have a burden where they need to be a little more proactive in finding out that information. You know, the information's there. If you ask, ask and you shall receive, right? So I think if spouses become a little more proactive in wanting that, maybe a campaign empowering spouses to know they have rights too. And they have a right to information as well, without making anything required or mandatory, but saying you have just as much right to know as your husband. Just that empowering message may bring more spouses out of the woodwork and let them know that they have a right for information.
What's the, is there some things we could learn about outreach using social media? I assume most people are connected to their family and friends on Facebook, but are there other... There are other kind of places to go to deliver those kinds of messages, like you just said. Like how would you reach people?
WorkSource, we are. I am a part of the Fairchild Spouses Facebook page, so I post on there. I post WorkSource activities, but also jobs that are available. And we also have our Airman Family Readiness career page that we also post on, and we're a team in working on this, probably a very well-oiled machine. I think we've really developed this and continue to develop it over, you know, what the needs of our customers are. But we are very much active on social media at Fairchild Air Force Base, as far as WorkSource goes, in the presence of the Airman and Family Readiness Center. So I think with military spouses, the one thing, keep sitting chair aside with them. Another thing that I hear repeatedly, if I am asking them for any identification information, is, oh man, I don't know, I could give you my husband's or my spouse's. So their identity is really wrapped up because of military. It's your secondary. It's what your, you know, any information that you need, your spouse needs to get it for you, everything. So I really see a need to separate and say, this is not veteran services and active duty services, and then we're going to kind of just put military spouses onto the, attach them to that, but say this is specific only to military spouses. This is for military spouses. This is about military spouses, because they do give up so much in their service to our country. So if they had organizations, or if they had opportunities for funding that was specifically set aside for just military spouses. And they were made, I think a part of it, and correct me if I'm wrong, is feeling important and feeling a part of our community and saying, you know, we do appreciate you, and we don't, you're not this person's spouse, you're you, and this is your identity, and we realize that, and we want to treat you as the respect that you deserve as a military spouse. So that's
just welcome packets. Do welcome packets get sent to folks before they transition in?
To the active duty.
I think it depends on the squadron too, because I'm going to say from my squadron's point of view, it is not as probably well done as other squadrons' point of view.
Yeah. So you indicated 3 years you didn't know about that resource.
Roger was looking for a key spouse, and I was like, you know, let me check out the aura on base, let me see what's going on, because we were living off base and we were quite disconnected because we were living off base 45 minutes away. So that disconnect, I withdrew from the base. Mm-hmm. So when he asked me that, I said, okay, well, let me look up and see. So it was finding that information on social media that brought me back in.
And if their reply, I don't know how it's presented, but it just occurs to me that you're very good at telling your stories, and sometimes we need to use like creative ways, like little video clips where you say, hey, this is what happened to me, and so that peer-to-peer or that kind of like I've been through it, sometimes there's just a credibility and authenticity that's not the same if it's coming from an interested person who is in some ways an outsider, even though they care. So
one way I would think they could share, I don't know, at least for this area, I don't know if you guys have noticed, but the Spokesman Review has created what they call a Veterans Chronicle. And it's all about, there's an insert that's coming out in the Spokesman Review monthly that is just, it's all about veterans and family members, and there's a whole section on did you know, and so our service officers have done little pieces on did you know, maybe it's something about the GI Bill, maybe we should engage the spouses group and get some did you knows for the spouses would be one other way to go, and they do it on social media and in their actual paper. So
Mark, you want to add? Yeah, this timeliness factor, I guess, of getting to spouses when they're PCSing in here first to like, mm-hmm. so you don't have this long delay, because it takes time really to get portability of credentials and whatnot. So what else can we do to reach them earlier? We talked about the goodie bag that goes to them before they even PCS here, mm-hmm. and but of course DOD won't tell us information about folks and how to reach them. So mm-hmm. what mechanism can we use once we learn who they are coming here on the base, whatever squadron they're coming into, to get that done as rapidly as possible so you can get that Facebook connection made or get whatever connection made so they know what's in the ANFRC available to them and not have this 3-year delay that could occur.
A bunch of folks just raised their hands, and Rob, you were waiting for a second.
And it actually addresses that question, and I wondered if the audience, I was thinking about virtual services, so if some of these services, whether it be webcasting the TAP session so that spouses could be notified of and join, could you record some of the commonly repeated information and make it available at any hour, any time of the day, more of the getting the message out. So is virtual a viable option?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And we're here until you wanted to add in too, so.
Okay. All I was going to say is we do have some initiatives already going on that day. For instance, our transition specialist calls all of the inbound families every single month and asks them what they need, if their sponsor's been in contact with them. He also works with all the squadrons on the base to make sure their sponsorship program is up and running and they're getting the right information to the families. So we are doing a great deal of outreach. A lot of the time, the thing that we run into is a lot of people are in transition mode. And they're not really ready to get their hands wrapped around. They've got to get stuck at the kids and they have to get the kids enrolled in school. They have to find a house, which we all know is housing issues, before they even think about starting their career path. So we do reach out to them before they even, put boots on the ground on our base. We talk to them every single month. It's just that sometimes they're just not quite ready yet. They're just trying to find a place to live and a place that their kids will be safe and sound and all of that before employment is their consideration. But we have been making a great effort to reach out to people.
Okay, and you made a comment real quick regarding housing and availability.
Mm-hmm.
Is that something that affects issues
here?
Yeah,
it's huge. I'd say it's next to employment, it's the biggest factor.
Yeah.
Child care,
Fairchild is so small. I mean, coming from the Army side, so finding housing at Fairchild in the Army was zero. Like, they were like, you want what? I was like, seriously?
Yeah.
So, I mean, it was a good thing I was from Spokane, but my husband was like, they don't have housing? Like, is that possible? And I was like, no, they don't. So, of course, we were fortunate enough. I'm from here. My husband's from Leavenworth, Washington. That was obviously not a commute we could make from Leavenworth.
but we could, living, you know, here. I had to, you know, take the farm back with my mother. But, you know, at the same token, it was housing and it was close to base.
We have less than a 1% vacancy rate in Spokane County, and so there just isn't housing. There just isn't any, and if you can find it, it's exceedingly expensive. We joke all the time, oh, we can sell our house because, hey, yeah. Woo, but
well,
we can find another one because
up.
There aren't any. Housing and daycare, I think, are the two big pieces because that's what you got to hit first, and then you can worry about the other things in a way.
And there's only one daycare in Airway Heights, like Center.
Yeah. And there's 2.5 in Cheney.
Yeah.
And 1 in Medical Lake.
So you know them all, don't you?
I do.
Yeah.
They all have waiting lists.
Yeah. And Spuddy
all have
waiting lists. And I probably use every single one of them. And I think that, I mean, because I couldn't get into OnBase.
Yeah.
And I'm sure that, you know, because that's what happens when you can't get in. You find what's close.
Yeah. I just got called from Giggling Guest 2 weeks ago. My kids are now out of daycare.
Yeah.
And I finally got off the wait list. And I've been on the wait list
and
for 2.5 years.
There once.
Yeah. It's like, oh, great. I don't need it anymore. Next person in line.
So back to our housing.
Yeah.
We've been in for 22 years. My husband's been active duty. Our mortgage and our electric bill are more than our BAH. So our housing loan. So our, what we have, and if we were, we put an offer on the house while we were in the house looking at it because that's how bad it is. You can't think. You don't have time here to think. So we were lucky enough to find a house that we could put an offer on. We put an offer on, we bought it. Our BH isn't enough to cover it. So then on top of that, you have the spouse who maybe can't work or can work or has challenges, child care, and then a house that's...
And 45 minutes away.
Right, and your BH is being taken up and you're paying over your BH for your basic care. So if you live on base, you know, you don't pay water, you don't pay electric, those are covered. Your BH can't even cover that off base here. So that's a definite challenge for families and spouses. And then when you add it all together, you get a whole picture of frustration.
And BH is still the same for the same rank, whether you're living on base or off base.
Yes.
There's no sliding, correct?
No, same.
And is there a waiting list for on base?
Yes.
It's almost as bad as the daycare waiting list.
Yeah. Actually, you might get daycare before you actually get
We were scheduled for up to 3:00, but I think we've had a pretty rich discussion. Are there any other issues that you have that we need to be able to capture before we conclude this amazing opportunity to be able to speak with you?
So I would like to capture, we just touched on EFMP families earlier, and the opportunity, and Ms. Levine asked if there were anything, what could the state do? Military spouses would love some telecommuting, work from home opportunities.
Mm-hmm.
I think administrative jobs, if those were, those are actual jobs that if they PCS out of the Spokane area, that they could potentially do from home and continue that employment, and then that would potentially increase that opportunity for them coming back into our local economy when they retire. So especially EFMP with the exceptional family members, I met with one this weekend and she has, there's just nothing for her. Her child has Down syndrome. She has absolutely cannot do anything. She deals with 1 week, he's feeling well, 2 weeks, he's ill. So those are the challenges that they have with individuals with disabilities. And again, they're coming in not with a support system, not with a network. They can't call an aunt or an uncle. They don't have nursing available that they've got lined up or set up. And so these are just some, you know, basic things that the civilian population takes for granted. And our communities are not really on board or aware of these challenges for military spouses. But if the state would like, you know, and that onboarding, getting a job, the process with federal, state is forever, you know, government employment can be forever. So maybe expediting some of that. But I think if we could possibly open up some opportunities, the call center, that are helping. I will tell you that military spouses are the most resilient. They are at work on time. They are there. That would not ever be, I just hands down would lay that hands down that they would be those loyal employees. So.
And just to give a little background, so due to our amazing healthcare system here in Spokane, Fairchild is one of only a few bases that can handle almost any type of EFMP family. So in the military, if you are about to PCS to a base and you find out that they don't have the correct care for your EFMP family member, you're not allowed to PCS there. So Fairchild in the Spokane area has medical to cover most any situation. So that being said, we have a large population of EFMP families here. I think at the latest count, when I talked to our coordinator, we are over 380 families in the EFMP system right now at Fairchild.
The Spokane School District has the same thing going on because there are good healthcare services. Mm-hmm. It's a center where families from all over Eastern Washington and actually in the Northwest and beyond sometimes end up migrating here specifically because those services are available for their kids.
The problem is we have a problem with respite, though. You know, they can't access respite as readily. A lot of times sometimes it's because they're stopped at the gate. They couldn't get respite care because they can't get base access. So that prevents a lot of our spouses in that field as well. So I get calls about that a lot.
So one suggestion that actually stemmed from something that Commissioner Levine stated was opening up positions more broadly, especially recruiting to military spouses, translating the requirements, the job posting requirements into skills rather than specific experience. I'm finding that there's a fair bit of narrowness, and I know I'm to some extent adding some work to myself because I'm part of this solution, but the recent experience was my wife graduated her master's in school counseling, and I was looking at a position within our own organization as an instructor for a particular program, and looked, and the posting was such that she didn't necessarily qualify and probably wouldn't have made it through the screenings, but yet as a former school teacher and a master's degree graduate, many of the folks in this room may well be excellent candidates for that, but I'm not sure their experience would qualify. Just on the basis of the wording of it's the degree and X years of experience in one of these areas. Well, one of those areas isn't all-encompassing. If you had experience teaching in Siberia, you could probably handle strategies for success. So.
I just
want to
do the same thing with our Department of Commerce job applications in a couple of areas, saying we might be leaving people out because this is a pretty rigid requirement. Mm-hmm. When people look through it, they're like, oh, this many years of this and exactly this. Like, there are actually people who probably have experiences that would be really interesting for us to talk to, and this is going to screen them out of the equation.
That's why I love that combination of education and experience qualifier.
But we were even talking on USA Jobs. I mean, if you don't hit the exact keyword, the computer's dumping you out even to begin with. And so, like, how many opportunities have been shut down for people best because of a computer system that's solely looking for certain little things and it dumps out everybody else? And I really think that's probably happened to probably a lot of us in here. We go apply for something and we're like, I'm perfect for this job, and it dumps you out. So I think that's particularly true, I mean, for military spouses and regular spouses, but we're so dependent on computer systems and stuff to go through that. How many people are getting left out of opportunities because of 1, 2, 3 words?
Yeah,
I mean, it comes literally down to 1, 2, 3 words.
You're taking the human factor out and made it just a computer keyword.
There's whole classes at WorkSource that tell you, oh, you got to make sure you use all your keywords.
Yeah. And I think that's where using your resources comes into effect, because I had that same exact issue. And then I went and saw Mr. Ramos in Miss Medlin, and it was solved. So I'm just using those resources, I think, are key, too. So you don't want to take almost too much responsibility, because as spouses, we need to step forward, use our resources as well. Mm-hmm. We are resilient.
we are powerful and we know we have those and we know what resources we can get from there. It needs to be a little more information, but using those resources. Mm-hmm. I had that exact same problem with the wording of my resume. Miss Debbie helped me reword my resume and I lucky enough to found a new career within a week just from rewording everything.
So you're pretty much closing the session, you know, with some of the lessons and some of the things that we want, not only this group, but, you know, those who are watching and will be watching in the upcoming weeks, because part of that is going to be that, first of all, work sources or American job centers or those employment resources in every state are available, number one. Then number two, it doesn't require for somebody to just go there and put that their information in the system, which is the American job system, is a system altogether. So when you put your resume in, and correct me if I'm wrong, you're making yourself available to everybody in the country, correct?
About 2,400 American job centers.
2,400 American job centers. And in some instances, those are actually looking for certain skills, and if you meet those skills, they're gonna call you. You know, that's something that happens. You know, and Washington State, we have something that is called Yes Vets, where, you know, where we have, and this is primarily, this is for veterans. But we're making an effort now to be able to find how can we use a similar system to be able to enter spouses. And Sam can just speak a little bit about that as we close out.
Certainly. Yes Vets is a very successful program we launched in 2016 across the state. To recognize employers that are hiring veterans into their workforce. And since its implementation in February 2016, we've seen about 4,000 veterans hired across the state by roughly 1,000 employers. So the governor signed an executive order earlier this year dealing with a lot of issues around military, not issues, a lot of items around military spouses. And one of those was wording that's very similar to what we saw when we launched Yes Vets. And that was one of the reasons that Alfie and Susie and others decided to come out and hear this. Does it need to look like Yes Vets, or maybe do the spouses have unique requirements that we want employers to recognize that are maybe a little different from what veterans have? So that's part of all of this, as Alfie said. But it's a great program, and no matter what we make it look like, I think it's going to be beneficial to the spouses. It's going to help get you a little more recognition for the superior skills and the superior traits that you bring to the workforce, to the employers across our state.
Okay, so we're in closing remarks, Lisa.
Thank you for sharing this. It's going to, for me, we'll definitely pull this into the recommendations we make on the childcare task force that we're working on right now. And as I said, we also are looking at this affordable housing issue, which is statewide. And I think there's a misperception that somehow this is a Seattle issue or a big city issue. No, this is across the state issue. This is a rural community issue. And so it's on us to be able to help deliver that message. But I think having your stories are going to help with that. And we're actually trying to look at some creative ways where, what if we are doing some multifamily affordable housing? What about having childcare connected to that? Because we all know having it either connected to where you work or where you live is a really key thing. If you're a working parent, you don't want to add a third location into the equation, right? It really needs to be one of those two places to really fit into the family's schedule. So thank you for that, and I'm looking forward to being able to turn some of these stories into recommendations, get this in front of the governor and the legislature, and hopefully make some changes that will benefit the families and spouses that come after you.
Mark, Jenny, would you like to?
Yes, please. On behalf of Commissioner Levine, I would like to thank you for your candor, but for also your willingness to drop in your own experiences. It's quite powerful to hear from your own life experiences and the movements that you've encountered. As you think of WorkSource, pushing away that stigma of the unemployment and looking at it from a work perspective, we recognize that a work life is much longer now than what it once was. It sometimes starts a little later, but it lasts a little longer, and there are many phases of a work life. Needs change. Sometimes it's a part-time need while I'm going to school, and other times it's that executive position that I worked so hard for. And we want to supply that service and be able to guide you and give you the resources available in achieving your personal work goals. Think of our system as a living one. We recognize that the work world keeps changing more rapidly than what it once did. There was a slower pace many years ago with artificial intelligence. We have a hard time keeping up ourselves, but know we have a responsibility to do so. And one of the pieces that we didn't talk about a lot today really is that key labor market information. What skills are highly marketable and where are they marketable? And that is something that we take pride in having available for our job seeking customers and our employers. So continue those plugs for WorkSource. That was wonderful today. And if you have other ideas on outreach, because I was very intrigued with your off-base need for outreach, please don't forget us. We'd love to hear from you. Thank you.
Yeah, I'll just echo that. Keep telling us about your experiences, the challenges you're facing, what's working and what's not, but keep communicating to us because it is an organic system. We can develop responses over the course of time. Some of these big ticket items like credential portability, we can't solve that. That's going to be up to them to take care of that, so we'll leave that in your capable hands. But we can do a lot of things on the ground here locally to get you connected to resources and services that are going to make the difference and give you, you know, the job that you need and the career path that you want to be on, the best of our ability. Debbie's doing great work, and Mike's doing great work. We've got assets on the ground here that are doing this, and plus a whole system available that can help you outside the base as well. So, I mean, our whole mission in life is to connect you to that career. That's all we, you know, exist to do, essentially, so please use us for that. And we also want to work on this nationwide piece, that recognizing that wherever you make PCS next, if you're retiring, that's apropos, but if you're going to go somewhere else, you've got this system in place to help you. And so how can we make sure that everyone knows that when they go to that next step in their journey, it's waiting for them there as well. So we've got we've got a great system in place. Let's make sure we're using it and just keep talking to us about, you know, what the robots are.
And I should add that there's a lot of work actually been done by Sam with his counterparts around the country in trying to make that movement across. So if you are, or you know somebody who is PCSing to another part of the country, they can connect to a work source here and get a warm handoff to the American Job Center in the location that they're going to. And similarly, we are asking our partners in other parts of the country with base adjacent American Job Centers to do that warm handoff back to us so that we can get upstream and help folks land on their feet when they get here. I should also add that we will follow up with you. I will send you an email with a link to a survey, so if there's something that you think you missed that you just burningly want to be able to share, that we will collect, there will be another venue for you to be able to share that information. And if you know somebody who was not able to attend today, please forward it on to them as well so that they can share their insights and thoughts.
So listening is cheap, really cheap. Action is where the rubber meets the road. So the one thing, you know, as Lisa mentioned, is how are we going to make what we talked about actionable to make sure that we can come back to you and say, okay, this is what we're planning, because we want to do that. We want to be able to, as a result of this, be able to have results. If we don't, we might as well just pack our bags and just go somewhere and not show up again. You know, so you're going to be hearing from us as we go along. We'll probably send the executive order. We need to be able to send it to everybody so you can see what it looks like, the things that the governor said that we're going to do in Washington State, because we really mean this. We mean every single thing that is in that executive order as far as the recognition of what military families are going through and the things that we're going to be doing as a state to be able to mitigate that, and then using the feedback to be able to do either legislation, rules changes, new stuff, and all of that. There is hope. I will tell you right now, there's one agency, which is called the Department of Children, Youth, and Families. They have a military spouse telecommuting from Germany. Germany leading an IT team in that particular agency. you know, and we just kept our fingers crossed, and I said, I need a report after the first 6 months to make sure she's still there. It's been about 10 months now. She's still leading that team. Mm-hmm. It can be done, but it's not easy, and it requires stepping out of the box. And as a state, I think we need to be the first ones to do that instead of asking everybody else to do it. You're going to see that there are going to be more opportunities when it comes to e-work that is going to allow the EFMP members, as it was said earlier, to be able to have meaningful careers that hopefully will be able to be transferable no matter where they go to ensure that they can be successful. But it's one out of thousands and thousands, but I think we're going to see a slow roll of positions that are going to be able to do that. So I just want to, on behalf of Lisa, myself, and Susie, to thank you for being here today, and you know, to just continue taking the word out to other spouses, using your social media to promote WorkSource and a lot of the things that they're doing, and a lot of the programs that the base has. I think it would be good to be able to use even this group and just fire to them again. What is it that we is offering to spouses? And then you can continue just, you know, just pushing it out the system, your social networks, because that's the only way that you're going to get more people involved. So thank you again for being here today, and safe travels home.
Thank you.
Give yourself a